You are more than my words. but we spiritually respond to your presence. That is worship. When we begin to sense the presence, the spiritual people can discern spiritual things. And so when we begin to feel the presence of God, not with our emotional feelings, but with our spiritual feelings, when we start to sense the presence, then we respond to you in it. So God, this morning, I pray that we would respond to your presence. In Jesus' name. So on. And, you know, it helps to know that at the midnight cry, despite all the death, destruction, decay, and so on, at the midnight cry, we'll be going.
Ever been. I areas and things like that. Our hearts were stirred, they still are, after every report of the tragedies. I can't even, you know, that picture that's up there doesn't show close enough, but you remember the people jumping out of those buildings and the different things that was going on and everything that took place from that standpoint. And we saw people seek God like we never saw before, at least in my lifetime, in the way that it was. And the issue is that after time has passed, we went back to life as it was normal. So here's the title for the day. 911, the need to take God seriously. 911, the need to take God seriously. I wonder if we really walked in the building taking God seriously today. Did you come into Bible study back there this morning? Did you take God seriously? Or was it just another day? Well, it's Sunday, and I want to put on my duds, and I want to go down to the building, and I'm going to hear somebody teach, and maybe sing a little bit, then I'm going to head out the door. I'm going to do my own thing. Or did you really take it seriously and think, you know, God, I'm expecting you to do something today in my life. God, I'm looking forward to what you're going to do. I'm excited, God, about what you're going to do today. And God, I'm excited. Maybe you wake up in the morning, it's Monday morning, and my dad and I used to, there's an old folks term that used to call it Blue Monday. And, you know, I wonder if your Monday's a Blue Monday or if it's a God Monday. Are you ready to go? Do you take him seriously? That's what I'm saying to you this morning. You've been in here recent days and weeks. You know, we've been in Hebrews, and we've been looking at Hebrews chapter 11. Where we're going to be today, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. And then I'm going to take you to Matthew, and we'll say a word about Genesis, just in the background, some things like that. So you're going to hear some things in regards to that. But I just wonder, if you're thinking about faith, the faith aspect. Remember what we said faith did really means, that God is, and that God will. That we really believe God is, not some kind of fairy tale kind of mixture of things where we just say, well, I believe in God, and we go on about our business. I believe there's a guy named Jesus, but, and we finish that statement. No, I'm talking about the fact that God is. That when you walk outside and you touch a leaf on the ground, you realize that God created that. That God created that leaf, that he created me, just like he created that leaf. That God, you see a worm on the ground, God created that worm. That we really realize that God is. That you're not a self-made person. That I'm not a self-made person. Who we are is a result of the touch of Almighty God. Where you sit this morning, what you think, whatever's going on in your life, God is real. God is, and God will. And so this morning we think about this and we take it a step further. 911, the need. The need to take God seriously. You see what happened back those 15 years ago, we realized that our nation was vulnerable. We were not bulletproof. And people ran to the houses of worship, and they began to pray, began to seek God, which was all good. And lives were changed out of that. God was glorified. But the sad fact about that is life returned to normal for some a few days later. It didn't happen long term. It didn't stay long term. You see, that's, and even in the midst of what we're seeing with the tragedies of police shootings and innocent people getting shot and all this kind of stuff, and people are groaning and they're having the prayer times and all that. But listen, that don't need to happen when the tragedy strikes. I mean, just because of that, it needs to happen throughout. There's nothing wrong with those prayer times. But bless God, let's do it on a regular basis. Make yourself get down on your knees, praying and seeking the face of God every day. You don't necessarily have to come together. That ought to be a culmination of what God's done in your life. Today you ought to come and brought worship with you because you've been worshiping God 6 days. And on the seventh day, you're bringing it together with 200 other people to have a good time with you. You don't know, to be a bored time. Never should you ever come into a worship service and say, man, I'm bored to death. I didn't like it. I didn't like this. I didn't like that. You miss God. You miss what God had for you because you come in with a bad attitude. And your attitude got, I'm going to use a bad word, badder. It got badder because you walked in with a bad attitude. And the thing is, you didn't come in expecting God to do something. And you went out with a worse condition. And so I want you to see that. Look at what the Word of God says this morning. 9-1-1, the need to take God seriously. Verse 7. By faith, Noah. Well, that word faith is awesome right there when you begin to dig into it and look at it. By faith, when Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear. When's the last time you had holy fear? We're going to talk about that. Holy fear. Built an ark to save his family. By his faith. By whose faith? Noah's faith. He condemned the world, and he became heir of the righteousness that comes by, and there's that word again, faith. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that God, we would get off our blessed assurance and begin to understand faith, begin to understand prayer, begin to understand Bible study. God, when we come to places like this and times like this, and we come with great expectation, God, no matter what's happening in our life, God, we realize, as we studied this morning, we're created for the purpose of glorifying God. Whatever we're doing, wherever we are, glorify God. So Lord, teach us this morning about this aspect of really needing to take you seriously. Now that midnight cry, it's going to come. Are we ready? Are we ready? God, I pray that we are. I pray that we take you seriously. God, help us this morning to see through in your word. Holy Spirit, God, that you speak through me, speak into my life, our life. God, this morning, get the glory. It's not about us. It's not about me. It's not about this preacher. It's not about Jim singing that song. God, it's about us and our relationship with you. 9-1-1. We need to take it seriously, God. Help us, I pray in Christ's name. Amen. Yeah, time passed. And life kind of got back to where it was. It returned to normal. And we begin to say, you know, I got this. We're okay. See, that's what we think in America today. I'm okay. And we've got different ones, ISIS and ISIL and all that, just kind of filtrating in, and all the radical stuff that we're having to deal with. And I'm telling you, it's a time that you and I need to understand we don't have it. We ain't got it together. And we really need to take God seriously, to really follow the Lord Jesus Christ. And the need to be for Jesus to be injected in our life. You know, we see all of the facts of the epidemics. Whether it be HIV crisis or Ebola crisis or whatever crisis, and all the Zika virus down in Florida, all that stuff, and how it just takes control of everybody. But I'll ask you this morning, what about Jesus? What about eternity? All of that stuff that we're talking about is major. Man, it's major. And it's real. But I'm telling you, we need to be real about Jesus. Because I'm telling you, we're one day closer today than we were yesterday to that midnight cry. We're one day closer today than we were yesterday to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so as we examine the faith of Noah, as we examine the story of Noah this morning, I pray that it'll cause an alarm to go off in respect for your life and my life, to those that are watching on YouTube later on, that it'll cause us to really think about the need for God. And I know what somebody's saying. Well, you're looking back there at old Noah verses today. I want to call your attention to something. I want you to go to Genesis chapter 6. It'll be on the screen as well. But I want you to look at Genesis chapter 6. If I want to keep your copy of God's Word open this morning, I'm going to take you several different places. And I want you to see, and I want you to see something. Verse 11, chapter 6 says, now that God saw that the earth was corrupt and it was full of violence. And God saw how corrupt the earth had become. And look what it says, for all the people. He didn't identify a group. He says, it's corrupt for all the people on the earth. And the people had corrupted their ways. So God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all this. So I'm going to put an end to all these people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy both them and the earth. Now think about that. I mean, you go back to when the earth was just a few thousand years old, maybe 1,000. 2,000, somewhere along the way. We don't really know. The earth's about 6,000, 7,000, maybe 8,000 years old. But anyway, the deal is that God saw that the earth was corrupt and full of violence. And he looked at it again. What do you think he's saying today? I guarantee you he's not proud of where the earth is today. I guarantee you he's not happy to where he sees mankind is today. And I'm not Americanizing the gospel. The reason I called your attention to all right there, because you and I want to Americanize. Somehow or another, some folks have the idea that God gave us this, and it says the Bible that God has given us for the United States of America. That's not what it says. The Bible is written to all mankind. That's why God says for all people. And he looked on the earth. And he looks on the earth today. And he sees the epidemics. And he sees the fact of what's going on in America and around the world. And I'm telling you, if he felt like the earth was corrupt and full of violence then, think about what he must say today. I'm telling you, there's an urgency for the 911 call to be issued. The need for you and I to take God seriously. God looked on Noah, and he said, because of this, you can look there a little bit further, verse 14, he said, look on to the rock. The Word of God says that Noah did what God commanded. There's a major key there, and I'm going to say a little bit more about that, because it talks about the fact of Noah, by faith, did what God said. Noah, by faith, acted on the words of God. That's what I said to you a moment ago. We talk about faith. It's easy to say, well, I believe in God. I go to church. I go down there to that building down there with the rest of them. And I go and I attend and I go home. Is that really faith? I mean, if you're not really putting it into action, I don't know what the adult Bible study leaders did about the glorification of God this morning in Bible study, but I'm telling you, well, it took it to a whole different level of faith. Because the fact of glorifying God is putting your walk, putting your life in action. It's easy to say the words, but I'm telling you, it's difficult to live it outside these doors. But that's the call that you and I have. And by faith, Noah went to action. Really believing that God is, that God will. And you know, when you think about it, I mean, that's who we ought to be. When you look at the story of Noah, you find that others really didn't believe God. If you would allow me just to speculate this morning that, Noah. We know that Noah probably lived somewhere around Mesopotamia, somewhere between the Tigris and the Euphrates River. Well, I'm telling you, there wasn't a sea there. Matter of fact, it was pretty dry where he was. And all of a sudden, he goes out there and he's building this huge ark, and you can go back and you can look at this huge boat. You can go back and look at all the dimensions. Matter of fact, we may be putting together a trip to Kentucky next year, for anybody that wants to go up to see the ark that has been replicated up there. But Noah began to build this ark out in the middle of nowhere. Now, what did you think the people of that day, man, if they had a quick build that day, I'm sure they wanted to put him in the mental ward of Whitfield. I'm telling you, they come around and make fun of him. They did everything they could. They did everything they could to Noah. About that time, Noah believe God. That's the key right there. When we talk about believing God, walking with God, when you do that, then your life is going to produce. You're going to change. You're not going to want the life you had before Jesus Christ. You're going to want what God wants. It's totally different. So what I want you to see, first of all, this morning, when we begin to dig into this, is I want you to see the fact of Noah and his, I'm going to use a church term, because I couldn't really think a way I wanted to do it any different. Reverential fear. Reverential fear. Now, if you were in Bible study this morning, God told in Isaiah 43, he talked to the children of Israel, he said, you don't have to fear. That's two different words. What God said, you don't have to be afraid in the midst of the troubles and the trials and tribulations and everything's going to come. You don't have to fear crossing the water, the Red Sea, all the battles. You don't have to fear any of that. Why? Because I'm with you. There's your fear. Your reverential fear comes in at that point because they recognize and they believe in God. It's not the same kind of fear. God was telling the children, you don't have to fear what's ahead of you. But the reverential fear is that you recognize the awe of God. And Noah knew who God was. And several times in Genesis, you're going to find the words, Noah did everything that God had commanded him. Noah walked with God. Noah did everything that God commanded. Why did he do that? Because he stood in awe of God. Several years ago, I don't know how many years ago, I preached a message entitled, The Danger of Losing the Awe. I'm telling you, that's where a society is today, where many churches are today. We've lost it. We're not in danger of it anymore. We've lost it. People that sit in this building this morning, you know what's wrong with your life? You've lost your awe of God. You've lost the reverential fear of God. You know, Beth Moore does the Living Proof Bible studies and conferences that our ladies just went to. You think about that. I thought about that as I prepared for this, because that's exactly when she entitles that Living Proof. The fact is, our life ought to show the reverential fear of a holy and mighty God. The fact that we believe that He is, that we believe that He will, that our lives, that living proof, that every day when somebody takes a magnifying glass and they get down on our life, then they can see the aspects of God in our life. Why? Because we have a reverential fear. Because we look at Noah. Noah did everything God had commanded him. I'm telling you, why did he do it? Because he believed in God. That's a major difference in our life when we begin to look at what God really wants to do. That our lives ought to be the living proof that Jesus is real in our life. If we say we've got it up here, if you can just say the word, we put the stickers on our trucks and our cars about everything under the sun. But what does our life say about Jesus? What does the real you say about Jesus? The reverential awe. You know, when you think about a smoke alarm, why don't we put them there? So if it goes off, unless the battery goes dead, we know we better get up and check it out. Several years back, we were still in Brookhaven. 2:00 in the morning. Smoke alarms go off. Man, I come up out of bed and the first thing I do is steam hits me in the face, and I couldn't see, it was dark. I'm talking about a fear. Wasn't on fire, but the pop-off valve blew on the hot water. It spread hot water everywhere in the house, and the house was steam and set the alarms on. But we better respond to that. You know, you can go back, and I told you to go back and show your kids about 9/11. Go back and look at what happened at 4 Mile Island. Mr. Dorman, some of those guys that are here this morning, some of that probably don't ring a bell to you. 4 Mile Island was a nuclear power plant. Chernobyl. Across the ocean. Go look at what happened. See, those things should have never happened. You know why it happened? Because the operators refused to obey the alarms. When you go and look at 4 Mile Island, and it's interesting that the plant still held together, but all the alarms were telling the operators what was going on. And they said, no, this can't happen, and they would hit the bypass. No, this can't happen, and they would hit the bypass. Same thing in Chernobyl. And you know what? If you go and research and you look down, of course, Chernobyl got so much worse. The melting. 4 Mile Island still held together. But that was so interesting when you think about that. I'm telling you, they ignored the warnings. And I'm telling you, what we're doing in the world today is we're ignoring. We got some daddies in this place this morning. You're ignoring the warnings that are coming up on your family. We got some mamas, husbands, and wives that are ignoring the warnings that have come up on your family. And you're just pushing the button. This can't happen. Listen, we can go around the building this morning and we probably get 50 or 60 testimonies where we hit the ignoring button and we let it go, and what it's produced in our life has not been good. In some areas, it's meltdown. Because we've ignored God. And I'm telling you, when we look at it today in our nation and we look at it in our world, we're ignoring the warnings. The signs of the times. God has given it to us. The Word of God says that we read that a moment ago, that God had laid it out there. But the thing with Noah was, in verse 7, when warned about these things, listen, not yet seen, in holy fear, Noah got on a log. And he built a You came in the building this morning, you hadn't heard about Jesus. You didn't know about the second coming. You don't even know what that is. When you got in here, you heard. Now what you gonna do with it? Now what you gonna do with it? You can't ignore it no more. Because you heard. You heard that there's going to be a second coming. And the thing is that God has told us that we need to plan. And there's no better time for you, as the Lord would draw you right now, there's no better time for you to get it right than right now. Noah acted on the word of God. He didn't debate with God. He didn't wait around and say, God, we'll talk about this tomorrow. God, let's go to lunch next Friday. And you and I'll talk about it under whatever kind of tree. He didn't say that. The Word of God says that he got busy. And you know, somebody say, well, how do you know about this guy Noah? Verse 9, chapter 6 of Genesis. Write it down. Verse 9, chapter 6, Genesis says, Noah was a righteous man. He was righteous in the eyes of God. Matter of fact, it says he was blameless. Blameless among the people of his day. Think about that. I'm telling you, blameless among the people of his day. He walked with God. Now, here's the thing. We've already read about all the corruptness. All the stuff that was happening down the street on Main Street. We've heard about all of that. But yet, oh, Noah. Here's Noah. He's righteous. He's blameless. He walked with God. He lived amongst the people. He let people see Jesus in his life. Why? Because he had a reverential fear. He feared God because he knew who God was. He knew that God is. He knew that God will. That faith aspect came into play in his life. And I'm telling you, it caused him to walk with God. The second thing that you need to hear this morning. Not only is the reverential fear, but the revelation. God's revelation. Did you get that? Did you get it that there, when you look at Noah was born and he condemned and he became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. Man, the revelation of God. Why did he need the revelation of God? Because he had his wife and his sons and his daughter-in-laws. And as God looked around, he saw the whole earth, all the people. Everything was corrupt. And he looked and he saw a holy God. And he plucked him out. And God began to reveal his plan to Noah. And Noah was on task. He didn't play around. He got with it. He'd been given the revelation of God. I want you to look. Why do we need this? Somebody said, why do we need this sermon? It doesn't even apply to me. Go to Matthew chapter 26. 24. Matthew 24. Go to Matthew chapter 24. Look at what he says. Here again, you walked in, you didn't know about the second coming, you didn't know about Jesus. Here it is. No one knows about the day or the hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. And it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage. Up to the day Noah entered the ark. You don't think they were making fun of Noah? I'm telling you, they were partying, drinking, getting married, no thought for the ark. And they knew nothing. Look what happens. And they knew nothing about what would happen until. You read the rest of it. Because I'm telling you, when you think about it, here's what happened. The urgency. Noah, you're crazy. What are you doing building this boat out here in the middle of nowhere? Noah, do you understand what a boat does? It floats on the water. It doesn't sit on the land. God, Noah, It's time. And see, you probably hadn't realized this, but it took somewhere in the neighborhood of, we don't know exactly, but in a 100-year time frame, 70 years, 60 years to build an ark. You know, Noah wasn't employed at Middle East shipbuilding. He didn't have all the plans. God gave him a plan. He didn't have all the expertise and have the wells in the right order and the nails in the holes. He didn't have all of that. But God laid it out there for him. And I'm telling you, he did what he needed to do. God said, no. Go in there and shut the door. You don't get your family. He didn't tell him to shut the door. God said, they're still laughing. They're still getting married. Noah, I'll drink to that. Here, Noah. All of a sudden, clouds. The sky started changing. The clouds started rolling in. All of a sudden, there's a problem. Then again, down, and the water began to rise. People began to do what they could do. See, one thing you don't understand, right? Is the word pitch. It's the oily substance, if you will. Let me just use that term. The black part of the substance that Noah put on the inside of the ark. He put it on the outside of the ark.
Why he put it there?
To seal it, to keep the water out. When you go and look at that word in the Hebrew, and then you look at the word atonement in the New Testament, it's the same root. Now here's the deal. The pitch on the boat kept the water from coming in. The atonement for you and I, the blood of Jesus Christ, keeps the judgment of God away from us. See, the last thing that I want you to understand this morning is not only the fear of God, the reverential fear of God, the awe. Maybe you walk in here, you can care less about God. Your life, you go and do your own thing. You haven't picked up your Bible since Noah built the ark. You haven't read, haven't cared to read. You lost your awe. The second thing there about the revelation, you couldn't hear from God if he beat you like I did a moment ago, so your eyes went that crazy. You're asleep. The third thing is the righteousness of God. Just told you about the pit in that moment. The righteousness of God. You see, Noah understood the righteousness. Matter of fact, do you understand in verse 7, the latter part there, where he's talking from the standpoint of Noah. And look what he says. I don't want you to miss this because it's important. He says, by his faith, he condemned the world, and he became the heir of the righteousness. The fact of receiving from God the righteousness. Now, make a note in your Bible, because this is the first one. Noah is the first guy to be called righteous. You and I are an heir to eternal life in heaven. Why? Because of the atonement of Jesus Christ. We haven't done anything on our own. We are heirs to the throne. Matter of fact, we're adopted heirs. Under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, when you think about the atonement, it keeps the judgment away. And if you pretended you came into this building this morning, you didn't know about Jesus, you see some trading preacher beating on a table, tell them Jesus went to the cross for you. You may not know who he is, but I'm telling you, he's the Son of God. He's the one and only Son of God. And he went to a cross and he shed his blood. Matter of fact, he had nails put through his hands and his feet. His side pierced, crown of thorns on his head. He went to the cross for you and for me. The Bible says if we'll place our faith and trust in him, that we would not perish. That means die and go to the center cell. We would have it. Because what's going to happen? One day, you're going to die unless the midnight cry and Jesus returns. You're going to die. I'm going to die. And you're not going to have a chance to go, Jesus! Noah! You got that wrong. Because see, Noah's already happened. It's Jesus. And Jesus is alone. What you do with him now in the midst of the dash of your life has to do with all eternity for you. Your family. All. Faith is believing that God is. That God will. The ark is a symbolization, if you will, of salvation. And it was salvation for Noah's family. But it symbolizes even looking at it for you and I, the cross and what Jesus has done. That is our salvation. See, here's the thing that bothers me. We deal with people all the time that have come to the point where they just say, I'm not sure I believe God in this area. I don't know if God would do this in this area of life. Well, see, once you do it in one area, then it becomes so much easier to do it in another area. It's kind of like telling a lie. Anybody ever told a lie, and then you got to tell another lie to get past that lie, then you tell another lie? Sooner or later, you don't forget what you lied about to start with, you tell a whole bunch of lies. It's the same thing. It happens. So what does God say? You and I need to understand the righteousness of God, that we stay close to God, that we believe God is, that we believe God will, that we'll walk and we'll live where God wants us to live and where he wants us to walk, that we're righteous by faith in God. That's the key. And as I close this morning, Noah, according to the Scripture, condemned the world. Noah condemned the world. I want to ask you, what in your life when you walked in this morning needs to be condemned? See, I asked our class this morning, I wrote up there, what does your life look like, or what does it look like for you to glorify God? For you, what does it look like? If I tell you to glorify God, or ask you for glorify God, what's your answer? And I want to follow that up. Is anything in your life that you can do? I'm not going to tell you the list that our folks put as distractions. But we need to crucify those things. We need to condemn them. We need to lay them down, and we need to look at where God really wants us to go, because faith is really knowing that God is and that God will. And the fact is that we're in a 911 time where we need to take God seriously. The urgency of the moment. For he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through Jesus. So what does it look like for you in your life to glorify God? see here in just a moment. I'm about to pray. I'm going to let our guys come and lead us. You're going to be able to stand and sing, and I hope you'll sing. But these altars are going to be open. Come anytime. But the Holy Spirit of God already let you know some things that need to be condemned. Maybe you walked in with that bad attitude this morning. Maybe you and whoever had it out, you walked in with that on your mind. Maybe something you and God need to get straight, you need to deal with this morning. Maybe God's called you to the ministry this morning. Maybe God's calling you to the mission field. Maybe God's calling you to join the family of believers, become actively involved. Maybe God's telling you, church member, to get involved. Maybe you're doing something slight-handedly that needs to be brought to light and you need to move away from that because you know what you're doing wrong. It's not of God. God knows and you know right now. So I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer and ask praise team to make their way here quickly. We're going to stand and the invitation is going to be moved. Father, in the name of Jesus this morning, God, it's about you, it's not about us. Folks walk to this platform, maybe they need to deal with something this morning. I want them to have freedom to do that. God, I pray this morning, whatever needs to be condemned, we condemn. Whatever needs to be lifted up, we lift up. God, that we would rise up in the place where you want us to rise up. God, that we bow down where we need to bow down. God, allow you to be God. It's a 911 time. It's a time we need to be urgent about God. Father, help us in Christ.